So all this casting that we're doing with the fourth graders, uh-huh. we're actually doing with each outreach center right now, too.
This so we have a lot of Savannah, Georgia, casting going on. 5 FM, WRUU.org.
That must be, that almost must look kind of
community radio with Golden Soul.
Once you've got the cast, if they're just kind of standing out there or sitting out there on a table.
I appreciate you tuning in. It's time for Savannah.
It's very Halloweenish.
It is very Halloween.
I mean, I can just imagine someone coming into the
Kip Bradley studio program
there, wherever it is, you know, with the lights out or something and flipping on the lights and all of a sudden. And there are all these hands.
And Autumn Gary, outreach facilitator.
The material we're using is alginate. And alginate's the same thing that dentists use.
And also, in the second part of the show, we'll have Courtney McNeil, who's the chief curator of collections and exhibitions for the Telfair Museum.
Minty bubblegum. Includes the entire museum smells.
And she's going to primarily be talking about the Magnificent Rodin exhibition that is showing currently.
That's good.
Come on.
The Jepson Center.
Minty fresh. All right.
So it's going to be a great show.
So
I love the
take
Jepson.
It
to, love the
and just getting back, I'm going back
whole.
Around and jumping around.
Be
and
a
by
very,
the way,
very nice show.
If there's anything in particular that's going on that
morning,
you want to just make a point of talking about, feel free
for
to
you. So
shut me off and go into something that take us into a different direction. But the veterans art classes is
because
interesting.
Because before
that,
we get to the show
some
proper,
attention here recently in the newspaper.
I do, of course.
I guess it's noon to three every Saturday. Is that
very exciting?
Noon to three every Saturday. They meet every Saturday.
General
the
disclaimer:
Center,
the viewpoints expressed in the following program are not necessarily those of WRUU, its license holder, or its staff. There you go.
Found out about it.
The world famous WRUU.
There's a core group that meets every Saturday.
All right.
By Kenneth and Teresa Martin, who are sort of longtime.
So, welcome,
instructors
Kip.
For
Autumn, I am so happy to have you in the studio this morning. I appreciate you coming in.
Well, quite a while ago, but I think maybe about 10 years ago.
Oh, it's been going on that long. Wow,
yeah,
okay.
Yeah.
And is he a veteran or is he?
Kenneth is a veteran, yeah.
Okay,
mm-hmm.
All right.
Yeah.
So that makes a connection there, I'm sure.
Yeah, and a great painter, too. So,
And a great painter, okay. And what sort of, how would you describe his own work? I mean, is it?
He does a lot of portraits of, famous African American historical figures.
Okay. All right. Mm-hmm. Excellent. Excellent. All right. Are there programs that we've not mentioned? We've talked a little bit about the veterans art classes. I have marks to make, the fourth grade school tour, and just the summertime city program. Not that that's not enough, but I'm just wanting. I don't want to miss anything. If there is another particular program out there.
I mean, just all the organizations that we work with. We've added the Park Place Outreach.
Okay, that's interesting. Now, the executive director of Park Place is going to be my guest next week.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Awesome. Yeah, they're a great group.
They're a new addition this year,
right? Yeah, they're a new addition this year.
We just started working with them, yeah.
A bunch of younger people, mm-hmm. which is really fun, mm-hmm. so... and then we've got the Grace House downtown by the Greyhounds. Oh yeah. And we've got Barnes Center.
Okay.
Barnes Center. We did say Savannah Speech and Hearing.
Yeah.
Savannah Center of Blind and Low Vision.
Okay, they're going to be my guests before. I have been my guests before,
yeah.
but we'll be coming in a few weeks,
yeah.
I think.
Yeah.
A lot
yeah.
of good groups.
Yeah. There's several.
Yeah, we
There's
also
several.
We really want to say thanks to the people that help sponsor the program, City of
yes.
Savannah, and our other community partners at different locations. It's I think without their support or their funding, we
yeah.
couldn't do these great programs. So.
And the alginate.
And the alginate.
And the alginate.
Yeah.
The what now?
The alginate donated.
We had a donation from the Brassler Company for about $1,000. It's the Henry and Sheen Company, actually, and they for 1,000 pounds of alginate that we're using for these kids. It's pretty incredible.
Yeah, you should see how much alginate we have in the.
Yeah.
We've been
yeah.
stacking it like Legos in the studio,
yeah.
just trying to find space.
Is it what? I mean, does it come in? Is it a neutral color?
It's pink.
It's pink.
It's pink.
Yeah, and
okay.
it's powder form. and you add water and it sets up really quickly. So what's nice about it is it sets up in about 4 minutes.
Yeah.
So, you know, 4 minutes can be a really long time for a 9-year-old.
Yes. But, well, I mean, even for an adult under certain circumstances.
Yeah. Honestly, for a lot of adults, it can be too. So we can mix it, you know, thicker with hot water. There's ways to help it set up faster. Because it is true, for some people, that's a simple thing to do. And for others, it's not a simple thing to do.
I actually had like a plaster cast. Now, I don't know if it was, because it wasn't pink or anything. So I don't think it was this material, but made of my face.
Mm.
And I remember I had to, you know, lie still with that on me for, I think, something like 5 minutes. But that was the longest 5 minutes, you know. And it was like, oh, my face itches, you know, I can't scratch. I shouldn't even, you know, wiggle my face to try and scratch it or, you know, scratch the itch. And so, you know, you're just laying there kind of. But, yeah, I'm sure for kids that you do that, but they got to be delighted with the results.
Oh, it's really cool.
Yeah, it's fun.
Yeah,
they have
fun.
A lot of fun. They enjoy it.
Yeah, the whole process is fun too, because it's like sort of magical. Like you're putting your hand in this sort of liquid, and then it sets up.
That works very different. Yeah. I mean, that's than just a plaster cast type thing, I guess.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. The material is really perfect for what we're doing. And then it's easy to, you know, carry around because it's powder. So when I'm taking it to outreach, it's pretty easy to bring. And then, the whole process has been really cool. And they're learning about Rodin, which is, you know, he's kind of a rock star.
And they'll certainly get some more of him as they go through school. I hope, surely. I'm a little older, so I can't. And I don't have any kids, so I'm not sure what's going on in
school. They have really great art teachers.
Surely Rodin is still a classic who's taught in, as you go throughout, elementary school and high school and upper higher education as well, surely.
I think he's cool, too, because he faced a lot of rejection, and really didn't get moving till his 40s. So for a lot of people, I mean, he was always an artist.
Yeah,
he was always creating, but didn't get much recognition.
Right.
So I think he's a really great role model, too, for facing adversity and staying true to who you are and having tenacity and, you know. And he was doing things that were pretty rebellious for the time, you know, kind of out there.
Okay.
So it's cool.
All right. Excellent. All right. We've got, for those who are just tuning in, we've got a triple threat show today for you. All Jepson, all the time. We've had, and we're going to have to wrap up here just in a moment with Kip Bradley, who is the studio programs manager, and Autumn Gary, an outreach facilitator. We'll give them a minute here in just a second to kind of leave us with something, but then we're going to move on with Courtney McNeil, who is the main curator for the Rodin exhibit that's going on at the Jepson as we speak. So we've got lots of Jepson for you today, and it's good stuff because Jepson is a jewel of Savannah for sure. So, all right, guys, I hate to, boy, it seems like we just got started, but we do have to break away. I take, as regular listeners know, I take a bit of time at the end of the show, at the end of the hour, to talk about a few things and that sort of stuff. So what shall we leave them with? How would y'all want to kind of wrap it up or talk about things that are coming up perhaps, or just talk about what y'all do in general? What you're going to leave us with? And by the way, the website for the Jepson in general is
it's Telfair.org. I thought you were going to say it.
I was looking at Kip, Kip's looking at me, it's just
Telfair.org.
okay, so
and if you want to get to the learn page, you can press slash learn afterwards.
/learn to get to some of what we've been talking about today. The studio programs, the outreach stuff. Okay, good. All righty. So what? What shall we leave them with? Anything particularly coming up, or just you want to kind of wrap it up in general as to what's going on out there?
I have marks to make shows. You know, it's a really awesome show.
And, yeah.
The drop-in studio is really a lot of fun, and Autumn facilitates that too as well.
Yeah.
We have, you know, 5 or 7 activities that anybody can walk into the museum and do any day from 1 to 4, and so and that's really, I think, a great way to learn about the museum and experience it too.
Absolutely. Yeah. Just create, make art.
There you go. Yeah. Make art. That's right. can't go wrong. Make art. All right. Thanks, guys. All right, listeners, we're going to have a brief musical interlude as we kind of shift gears and go into the second segment here with Courtney McNeil, and specifically regarding the Rodin exhibit. So hang with us. I'm just going to put a little music on to tide you over until we get back, and we won't be gone very long at all. Thank you. little Ronnie Earle and the broadcasters. That's not a bad way to kind of take a little break, huh? All right. I'm glad you're still with us. This, again, is Wayne back with you with Savannah Lexicon, and it is a Jepson Center Day. And our first segment, hopefully you heard, we had Kip Bradley, Studio Programs Manager, and Autumn Gary, an outreach facilitator for the Jepson, and we talked about some of the special programs and outreach programs that they do with the Jepson. And now, in the second segment of the show, I am pleased to welcome Courtney McNeil, who is the Chief Curator of Collections and Exhibitions. Did I get that right, Courtney?
That's correct. Thank you.
All right, good. And which means also that she was kind of the primary person, I guess it's fair to say, of curating the magnificent Rodin exhibit that's there now.
Correct.
And that's going to be there. It's going to be there a while, but you know what? It's you don't want to let time slip away. I'll just put it that way. It's going to be there till when?
January 7th. So we'll have it on view through the holidays. But you're right. That time goes really fast. It will be here before we know it.
Yeah. And this is, this is world class stuff, folks. So this is good. Rodin. I mean, you know, everybody, all of us learned about Rodin in school, if we had any decent schooling at all. Hopefully you did. You certainly should have. I certainly did. And I guess let's just kind of maybe talk a little bit, if we may, Courtney. We're going to just get going here before we're going to have to take a break. But at any rate, we'll quickly. How did this sort of come about?
Well, at the museum, we have the great privilege of receiving many, many more exhibition proposals than we could possibly host at our buildings.
Yeah.
And we do present temporary exhibitions at both the Jepson Center and also at the Telfair Academy building. And I oversee the exhibition programs in both spaces.
Okay.
When the Rodin opportunity came our way, we felt like it was just too great of a chance to pass up. We're hosting this show in conjunction with the 100th anniversary of Rodin's death in 1917. So it's part of a worldwide centenary celebration with museums around the world hosting exhibitions and having programs celebrating Rodin's legacy on the occasion of the 100th anniversary of his death.
Okay. Well, yeah, good. It's good y'all are within the group that, you know, that can be have access to that sort of thing, and I hadn't thought about that. So it's I have seen that in the marketing or advertising or whatever, but that had escaped me. Yeah, he died in 1917. All right, good. So we really want to talk about Rodin and the exhibit and you a little bit, but it is the bottom of the hour. So, folks, that means that we do have to take a little break. So we just got started with Courtney McNeil, Chief Curator of Collections and Exhibitions for the Jepson. But we are going to have more, lots more with Courtney after just a little break.
The 7th annual Empty Bowl event is Sunday, November 5th, from noon to 2 p.m. at the Emmaus House Soup Kitchen at 18 Abercorn Street in Savannah. Pottery artists from SCAD and other groups donate bowls, and area restaurants provide soups for lunch. The fundraiser benefits the Emmaus House Soup Kitchen. For additional information, visit unitedministriessavannah.org or email emmaushousesavannah@gmail.com.
You're listening to WRUULP, Savannah, Georgia, 107.5 FM. WRUU.org. We are Savannah Soundings, community radio with Global Soul. And I just want to take a minute real quick. If your business enjoys our programming on WRUULP, please support the station with a donation. Let your customers, neighbors, and friends know that you share our vision of building a thriving community based on diverse, vibrant radio programming. As a business partner, our listeners will know that you support Savannah's only broad-based community radio station. Become a tower sponsor or underwriter. To check out the levels of corporate sponsorship and to donate, go to www.wruu.org/business. Again, to check out the levels of corporate sponsorship and to donate, go to www.wruu.org/business. Thank you for listening to and supporting WRUULP. Thank you for listening to Savannah Lexicon this morning. And during the break, Courtney reminded me of something that should be clarified. I've been kind of putting her as part of the Jepson Center. Technically speaking, of course, she is chief curator of collections and exhibitions with Telfair Museums, of which the Jepson Center is a part. And the Telfair Museums include the Telfair Academy, Owens Thomas House, and the Jepson Center. So that's a distinction worth making. I appreciate your pointing that out for me, Courtney. And so now, while we got you down for just a minute, let's do this. Just tell us a little bit about yourself. Give us a nutshell bio of Courtney McNeil and your art adventures.
Clarify, first of all, that I am not an artist myself, but just an art historian who enjoys studying other people's art.
Oh, well, don't say just, but okay.
it takes all of us, though, to make things
Absolutely,
happen.
Absolutely, it does.
So I grew up in the Boston area in Massachusetts.
All right.
I went to college at Georgetown University in Washington, D.C., which at the time I thought was venturing into the deep south, which, of course, now I understand is not the case at all. I did a junior year abroad program in London, in England, and I loved it so much that I went back for graduate school, and I got my master's degree at the Courtauld Institute of Art in London.
Okay.
And back to Boston, where I worked at a commercial gallery for about 4 years, primarily in the prints and drawings department, where I worked on prints from the Old Master era through about the middle of the 20th century. And then I came to Telfair Museums almost 12 years ago now, where I started as an assistant curator just before the Jepson Center for the Arts opened to the public. And I've been there ever since. And have worked my way through the ranks to become the chief curator. So I have this great privilege of having worked at the Jepson Center the entire time that it's been open to the public. So
nice.
I remember, hopefully, all of the projects that we've done there over the years, and they've been varied and they've been wonderful. So
nice. Okay, well, we're happy. I'll speak for Savannah. We're happy you're here.
Well, thank you. I'm glad to be here.
All right, so we have this magnificent Rodin, The Human Experience, selection of 32 figures in bronze by Auguste Rodin, French sculptor, of course. So I guess maybe tell us just a little bit about the man himself.
Yeah. Well, Rodin is exceptional in that he has such great name recognition, right? Everybody knows The Thinker, everybody knows The Kiss,
right?
But a lot of people don't realize how extensive his work was in exploring the human figure. He had an interesting background. He came from a fairly modest working class background in Paris and really stumbled early in his career. He was not able to gain admission to the most prestigious school of fine arts in France.
Uh-huh.
And he really did not achieve professional success as a sculptor until he was well into his 40s.
Oh, you well, know, this is good. This is encouraging
it
to
is.
Many, many people
I
out
think
there.
It is.
Yes.
And, you know, he worked as an assistant to other sculptors early in his career.
Mm-hmm.
So he had a great technical ability, and he worked as a modeler, taking the master artist's vision and then bringing that to life. And then when he was able to achieve recognition for himself, he went on to also have this massive workshop of artists, sometimes as many as 50 sculptors working under him in his studio, where he would provide the direction, but these other sculptors would do the lion's share of the work. And then, of course, the molded figures went off to the foundries, where it took teams of folks who were able to then take the wax or plaster or clay model and turn that into a bronze figure like the ones that we see at the Jepson Center. You know, many of the figures that you see in our exhibition too had many different lives during different times in Rodin's career. A lot of them started as smaller pieces of larger scale works, like his massive Gates of Hell that are really famous. Those were actually never cast in full during his lifetime because they were a commission. The commission got canceled, and it would have been way too expensive for Rodin to cast them himself. So he liberated many of the figures from the Gates of Hell and then cast them and sold them as independent figures. So he was really inventive and resourceful in recycling and reinventing his own work.
Excellent. And this particular exhibit that is going on now, 32 figures, and you've to some extent talked about that and what they are, but tell us a little bit more about these particular figures that are on display at the Jepson.
Well, these figures taken as a group help illustrate a couple of really important points about Rodin and his career. One of those is that Rodin felt that a fragment of the human body could be a complete work of art in and of itself. And that was revolutionary at the time. He was coming from a tradition of very academic sculpture where folks were literally trying to duplicate the human body as faithfully to nature as possible. He wasn't interested in that. He wanted to take fragments. He wanted to distort the figure to make it more expressive and more individualized. He would enlarge it to be larger than life, or he'd sculpt it smaller to get across a smaller idea. So he was really interested in using the human form to express an inner state of mind. Another important point that this show makes is Rodin's interest in movement and in dance. A lot of times the works that you'll see are not, they're not completely static. They're either evoking the idea of how they were just moving a moment ago, or they're holding a pose that would be so impossible to hold in real life that you can't help but imagine the next movement that the figure will make. So this idea of movement is really ever present in his work as well.
Nice. I'm glad. You know, I'm glad to hear somebody talking about it. It always is so helpful to me, and this is just an aside by me, I guess, which may or may not be pertinent. I don't know. But, you know, I say things that come into my mind sometimes.
Well, you're the host. That's
your the host, so I get to do things like that. But I know that I've always appreciated art, but I've never been a serious art student, and I have, like many people, I sometimes have a hard time conceptualizing and certainly putting into words, but even frankly conceptualizing in my own mind, what it is that appeals to me about a piece. And I really discovered later in life, I must say, how valuable it is to have, to get a good narration if you're going to a museum, or to speak with somebody knowledgeable such as yourself about these kinds of things, who help, who articulate what I can't myself in my own mind. You know I really like this or that, and I appreciate it from an aesthetic point of view, and I appreciate it from something beyond pure aesthetics. But it's very hard to put a finger on it for many of us. And you know, the way you just described that, I thought, yeah, that is it.
Well, thank you for saying that. I think that's a really common dilemma. And, you know, that's really why we have highly trained docents at the museum who offer tours and who've spent hours being trained on this material to help, you know, not to just sit there and talk at the visitors, but to help them see things in a new light or to point them in a new direction so they can make their own discoveries about the works. And it's a beautiful thing to watch. It really is.
Yes, absolutely. So, yeah, I think it's really a good idea to avail oneself at any museum of folks who understand these things better than a lot of us do. Okay, and so this magnificent exhibition is going to be continuing for a few more months. But again, these months go by quickly, particularly as we get into the holiday season and all that. So you all of a sudden turn around and it's the new year. But it's there. What are the hours of the museum? Do you know? I'm sorry, I'm throwing that out to you.
Yeah, numbers are not my strong suit. But
mine either. That's why I have to ask you. But at any rate,
we're open. So we have shorter hours on Sundays and Mondays. But okay. Tuesday through Saturday, we're open from 10 a.m. to 5 p.m.
Okay.
And well, then Sundays and Mondays, we're open from noon. Noon to 5, but check the website if you're coming,
check
because
website.
I want to make sure not to steer you wrong.
Plenty of information. And, of course, there's plenty of information online about this particular exhibit.
There is, yes.
Anything else? We still got a little time, but I do want to make sure we get to what we need to do. So I want to ask you two things. And the first thing just being, is there something else? Of course, we could talk about Rodin and about this magnificent exhibit for hours, but we can't do that as much time as I have. We can't go quite that long. But so I do want to ask, you know, if there's anything you want to sort of wrap up on the Rodin exhibit. The other thing is, excuse me, if you want it projecting ahead, maybe, if you want to tell us kind of what else is new or what else is coming in the near future.
Great.
To some extent.
Yeah.
So what, any wrap up on the Rodin exhibit?
Oh, sure. Yeah. I would love to just address my experience curating this exhibition.
Yeah.
When we decided to take it, I really felt humbled by the task of arranging this work in the gallery and coming up with an installation design that would do justice to the work of this incredible artist.
Yeah, no kidding.
And if you've been to the Jepson Center galleries, you know, they're really large soaring spaces. We do a lot of modern and contemporary installations there. And I wanted to make sure that the works, although a lot of them are quite large, they're not, they're not 15 feet tall. So
right.
I wanted to make sure the scale of the room would feel right to the works.
There's a
lot
that must go into that, Jen.
So there was. I mean, it was many months of planning. We've got a great installation design team, and they built the whole thing out. We do these 3D models in SketchUp, which is a free software that we use to build these things out and really get a sense of the space between works. We wanted to make sure that all of our sight lines were really compelling so that when you walk into the gallery, you see something really compelling from across the room,
right.
Down to the paint colors. We also have a number of large photo murals on the walls,
right.
Pictures of Rodin in his studio, a large-scale reproduction of the Gates of Hell so that you can see the large-scale monumental works that gave rise to the works in our exhibition.
Nice.
So a lot went into that, and I'm really proud of how it turned out, and I owe a great debt of gratitude to my team at the museum who worked with me on that, and it was a real problem to solve, but I feel like we did it well.
Now I can't say from her firsthand experience because I have to admit that I have not been there yet, but I definitely will be going. But it sounds so nice the way you have described that and the way you've designed. And here again, this is one of those things where a lot of folks who aren't particularly artistic, or at least not in that particular way, you know, we stop and think, oh wow, yeah, you and sometimes you might not, for novices or however you want to describe folks who aren't as precisely and nicely artistic as you and some other folks, you may not even realize what a difference that kind of stuff makes. And you may not even, when you go see it, but it works. Even if you don't realize it, it works at a subconscious level and clearly accentuates the presentation tremendously and helps you enjoy it tremendously.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, I feel like if you view the exhibition and you don't notice the installation and some of those details, then that's great. Then we've
exactly,
done it well.
Exactly.
But I'm here to give you the behind-the-scenes scoop.
And we appreciate that because, again, this helps us appreciate the work and the nice sensibilities, artistic sensibilities that go into all of this. But you're right. It's almost the kind of thing that you're not trying to draw attention to that. You're trying to accentuate the work, but what you do in the manner of what you were just speaking about, the way you present it, certainly just puts it in its best light, we might say. So that's great. I appreciate this description of sort of the artistic sensibilities that go into that. All righty. All right. Let's ask this now. What about coming up? What can we look forward to at one or more of the Telfair museums in the near future?
Well, we have a lot going on. You know, we rotate exhibitions every 3 or 4 months in all of our gallery spaces. Mm-hmm. We also just opened an exhibition at the Telfair Academy of Southern artists who were working in the Impressionist tradition. Mm. So Impressionist paintings of the South from about 1880 or so to maybe 1930 or 40.
Okay.
Some really beautiful examples of how American artists were taking this style of Impressionist painting that was originated over in France, and then employing it on Southern subjects like live oaks with Spanish moss, or you know, beautiful marshland scenes.
Now that sounds very appealing.
It's really stunning, and there are a couple of works in the show that have ties to Savannah that were made here in our city. So that's a wonderful thing to see as well.
Yeah.
So that's on view now, and coming up at the Jepson Center in the new year, we have a couple of really exciting exhibits that we're kicking off the year with, some modern and contemporary shows. And one of those is by Carrie Mae Weems, who is really one of the most iconic living artists working today. And she did this series of the Sea Islands of Georgia and South Carolina back in the 1990s when she was early in her career. There are these really haunting photographs that pay homage to the Gullah Geechee people who lived in these spaces and whose culture was so often underrecognized and really continues to be underrecognized today.
Yeah.
So this beautiful photographic series explores the culture of those islands.
Excellent.
And also early in the new year, we'll be kicking off with a major exhibition by an Atlanta artist named Paul Stephen Benjamin, who has recently achieved a lot of recognition. He's featured in an exhibit that's on right now at the Studio Museum in New York, but he is an Atlanta guy, and we are presenting his first major solo show at a museum here at the Jepson Center. So he's an African-American artist, and he's really interested in this idea of blackness as a color and also as a cultural identity. So he's exploring the color black through the paint that he puts on the walls, through the components of his installations that are often old TVs stacked in these towers together with all of the wires and everything visible. They're really haunting and beautiful.
To me now. Yeah, okay. All right. Excellent. 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 All right. Courtney McNeil, Chief Curator of Collections and Exhibitions for the Telfair Museums, and including, of course, among them, the Jepson Center. I appreciate so much you taking time to come in with us today, Courtney.
Thank you for having me. It's been a lot of fun.
Yeah, my pleasure. And gosh, I'm just glad that the whole Telfair Museum's operation is here. It's certainly a great asset to the community, and Rodin, in particular, right now, Rodin, The Human Experience, 32 figures in bronze, going until, again, the end date on this is
January 7th.
January 7th. So, all right. Thank you so much. I do appreciate it. And, folks, I'm going to, again, take just a very brief break. I will, again, put on a little Ronnie Earl in the broadcasters for your listening pleasures while we kind of get set up for the last segment of the program, so hang in there, won't be long. Thank you. Ronnie Earl and the broadcasters, Wayne, back with you. I appreciate you listening to Savannah Lexicon today. Got about five more minutes. I want to run some things by you. And by the way, I will mention, too, that the viewpoints expressed in the preceding program were not necessarily those of WRUU, its license holder, or its staff. And I want to let you know that coming up next week, my guest on Tuesday are going to be Julie Wade, Executive Director, Park Place Outreach, Youth Emergency Shelter, and the Executive Director, Ariana Berksteiner of the Emmaus Soup Kitchen, Emmaus Soup House Soup Kitchen. Ah, there we go. All righty, so that's going to be a very good show. A couple of they'll be together, so that'll be another double bill, if you will, here on Savannah Lexicon. And then on the 31st, next Thursday, I'm going to have a special Halloween show. That's all I'll say right now. It's just going to be a special Halloween show. We'll have a little fun. And, you know, some interesting stuff, too. And I'll also have some comments at the end of various things going on in the fine city of Savannah, too. So it's not going to be nothing but fun, but I always want to throw in some good information for you there to be aware of. But it's going to be an interesting show and a Halloween special show. There you go. Now, let's see. Also, I want to remind you that following me at 9 o'clock is Background Briefing, and then at 10, Democracy Now! So two shows that are very much about you know, the international, national, and international affairs that I think will be quite good for you as well after Savannah Lexicon, which, of course, is very much community-oriented, very much Savannah-centric. So a couple of good shows of a somewhat different manner for that. All right. So what's going on in this fine city? A number of things. Haunted Authors book signing, actually. Ryan Dunn, author of Savannah's Afterlife, True Tales of Paranormal Investigator, is going to be at E. Shavers Booksellers, 326 Bull Street, 3 p.m. tomorrow. And on Saturday, of course, begins the magnificent SCAD Savannah Film Festival, this being the 20th anniversary edition. And man, they have pulled out all the stops. If you were listening Tuesday, you learned all about it. And that's going to go from this Saturday through the following Saturday. And that is some kind of festival that they are having. It's great. Also, starting this Wednesday is the 3-day Pride in Savannah Festival, and they're calling it the Downtown Takeover. They may have to elbow some movie folks out of the way. I don't know. But this year is the first time the new area. They're actually having it at Ellis Square, not at Forsyth Park. So it's at Ellis Square. And, of course, there's all sorts of festival stuff going on, street fair, musical performance, all sorts of events around the city. So that's starting this Saturday as well. All kinds of Halloween stuff going on, too, throughout the day and throughout the week and for the rest of the week and even beyond, actually. And I am just about out of time. So I do appreciate you tuning in for Savannah Lexicon here this fine morning. It's been a good show. I hope you've enjoyed it. And thank you for listening to WRUULP, Savannah, Georgia. 107.5 FM, WRUU.org. We are Savannah Soundings Community Radio with Global Soul.